Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Well, there is a time in everyone's year, senior year and junior year, when you're told, where are you applying to college? College, I'm just getting through high school. How can I worry? But there's your parents saying, listen, we didn't send you to that private school that costs $32,000 a year, to not know where you're going and not even try to get early decision. Well, that's the title of my guest, Lacey Crawford's book, Early Decision, about certain colleges. You let them know, I won't apply anyplace else if you can let me in and let me know. Well, some of them don't want to let you know. And this story, it's fiction, but it's based on a true frenzy. And that's my guest book. Welcome, Lacey.
Thank you so much.
And what a charming book.
Thank you.
And in a way, what a pressure book, because what is worse than that pressure of waiting for the fat envelope?
That's right, or in these days, waiting to log on and find out over the internet if you've been accepted.
It just shows how old I am.
No, it shows that I was the same way when I applied, but now they don't even wait for the mail. They just go online.
You know, the worst part is I read the book, I thought, what did I write in my essay?
What did you write?
I don't remember. And it was quite a time. But tell me, the kids in this, they're very interesting, and you've got a wide variety of, I guess, 17-year-olds.
Right. There. So the book follows five students through the course of one college application season. It starts in August when their parents are starting to feel frantic, but they're still enjoying their summers, and it ends in January after they've submitted their last application.
Now, the girl woman who is the college helper, because she really isn't under any school.
That's right. She's an independent college counselor.
And?
She's a hired gun. Yes, mm-hmm. And
she gets her people by recommendation. Oh, she got my daughter into Harvard or my son into Yale. It's that passing on accreditations.
That's right. She basically is passed on from parent to parent by word of mouth for years, and over that time develops a pretty good sense for how to help a young person tell a story in his or her own voice.
And one of the leading characters of these students, kid named Sadie.
Sadie.
Tell our friends a little bit about Sadie's family, the Pfaffs.
Sadie's Blanchard, and she is a student who already has every privilege that most parents are looking for when they try to get their child into an Ivy League school. She's an heiress. She's the daughter of two very prominent Chicagoans. The book is set in Chicago. Her mother is something of a television, I want to say, sort of lifestyle guru. Her father's a very prominent lawyer. Her father is also the chairman of the board of trustees at Duke. And it is therefore clear that Sadie will go to Duke, because where else would she go? It's never been a question. Sadie, however, is not of a high enough caliber student to get in on her own, and she knows this. And because she's a good person and has a good sense of sort of the ethics of the school admissions process, she feels guilty about this.
Yeah. Not that guilty that she won't eventually go along with it.
She does go along with it, but she takes a pound of her parents' flesh with her. So
yeah. The mother is totally obnoxious.
Thank you. Yes.
And she plays on Anne in a way that you just want to punch her. But she truly is a pushy, obnoxious woman.
She is. She is a life coach, a self-styled life coach, who is fascinatingly devoid of empathy. She is unable to understand what anyone else is feeling, but she is very keen to give people advice on how to live their best lives.
Well, she wants to help Anne. I'll help you out. What do you mean you don't want my help?
Exactly. She's quite offended.
And then Sadie's father invites Anne for a lunch.
He does. And Anne is single and 27 and a little bit confused.
And attractive.
And attractive enough and a little bit confused. She has a bad boyfriend. She's not quite sure.
Boyfriend's an actor.
The boyfriend is an actor.
In Hollywood.
In Hollywood, trying to break into pilot season.
And he's 40.
And he's much older than she is.
Yeah.
Yes, that's right.
So Anne is in that in-between stage in life also.
That's right. I think it was very important to me that Anne, who is the college counselor for these five kids, not be a guru. She has gone to an excellent college, but that didn't teach her to make a life.
Yeah.
And I do think there are a lot of young people in their 20s especially who think they need to attach themselves to successful people at the expense of developing their own worlds. Mm-hmm. And that is a trap that Anne has fallen into with the boyfriend and perhaps also with some of the parents of her yeah. students.
Hunter is the tennis player.
Hunter, yes.
Describe him.
Hunter Pfaff is the only child of a hedge fund manager and his very busy stay-at-home mother wife who is facing the empty nest when her boy leaves. And she has wanted more than anything to deliver her son into a certain kind of WASPy glory, which to her means a certain school, and she won't take no for an answer. And she has done everything in her power to try to shape her son's experience, always with an eye to his resume.
And he has a cousin who went to Amherst.
He has a cousin who's gone there, and so they think that he's a natural fit, and it's quite a shocker when that doesn't work out.
As a matter of fact, his essay, as it begins, and that's a wonderful thing you have in this book, of being able to see how Anne, in working with these kids, gets them to have their own voice. What do you really feel?
Thank you. Thank you. Much of the story is told through the students' essay drafts. And when they begin, they are the voices of some scared young people who yeah. haven't always had their voices honored. And part of what Anne is trying to do is help them to understand what they really would like
yeah.
to say.
Yeah. Instead of writing a thank you note to your grandmother, it's saying, this is who I am.
That's right. Well, yeah. the extraordinary thing, and this is true, I think, for high school seniors all over the country yeah. today, right now, is you come to your senior year and you're expected to write a college essay, which this year, for most places, is 650 words. Nobody has taught you how to write a good first-person essay. This doesn't, yeah. it's not a book report, it's not a lab report, it's not a history paper, but it is probably the most important piece of writing you will yeah. have come up with. How are you supposed to do this? I mean, imagine yeah. the writer's block of these kids. So a lot of what I'm trying to write about in the book is how this can be seen as an opportunity and yeah. how young people can really use this to figure out what they want their next step to yeah. look like.
The third one is William.
William, yes. William is the closeted gay son of a very, very conservative plastic surgeon growing up in a rather conservative Jewish family. And he desperately wants to study theater at Vassar, and his father will have none of it.
And I love the fact that people are still thinking Vassar is only for women.
Of course, of yeah. course. I mean, I think even today, if we went out on the street and stopped five people and asked them if Vassar was men's yeah. or women's college, they would tell you.
Actually, so many women's colleges have gone co-ed, as have men's colleges.
Well, Vassar went co-ed before Harvard did.
Yeah.
But you'll never hear anyone talk about Harvard as, you know, an all-men's school.
I must say, I'm still glad that Wellesley has stayed all-female. They do have classes with MIT, but it's still female.
Were you happy there?
No.
Would it have been better with men?
Oh, of course. But on a scale of most kids, they're happier to be that way.
That's what I think. There is a place for single-sex education, even up through university. So there's Wellesley and yeah. Mills and Scripps. There are a few other places.
Yeah.
Not Scripps, but there's a woman's
Smith.
Place. Smith, obviously, yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, back at E's early decision, it's Anne's story, too.
It is Anne's story, too, yes. It was important to me that Anne be learning from her students, just as they were learning from her. So yeah. she is not that far ahead of them, actually.
And she lives in a condo, and above her is a woman named April.
April.
Who has no use for Anne or her dog.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. Well, April is a disgruntled single woman in her early to mid-30s who's entering a sort of zone of desperation that panics yeah. Anne because she's worried this will happen to her.
Now, I don't know, did you live in New York after you graduated from Princeton?
Not immediately. No, yeah. I didn't move to New York until my 30s.
I did, and there was somebody with my name. And yes, and she got some of my graduation gifts, and suddenly I'm getting a note from her saying, please come and pick up your gifts, and she signs my name, which is her name, And she was a spinster, sort of like April.
Right.
Scared the life out of me.
Well, exactly. Yes. Yeah. See, this is right. So there's a reason why April doesn't want Anne and her dog in the hallways. And
yeah.
It takes the course of the book to figure out what that is. But for the most part, April is one of those adults that Anne is forced to coexist with but can't quite understand how to make a community living near. And I think this is also an experience of the 20s, which can be quite alienating, particularly in big cities.
What made you put that in the book?
April?
No, yeah.
Oh, that's a good question. I felt very strongly that I wanted readers to keep turning pages. I felt very strongly that I wanted there to be several things going on at any different point in time. And I didn't want Anne to be just a girl in an apartment building. I wanted her to be trying to work out, based on the people who lived around her, what it looked like to have an adult life. Mm-hmm. And on the ground floor, beneath Anne's apartment, is a lovely and very happy married couple who are expecting their first child. And they look to Anne like the picture of all that is perfect and possible in adulthood. Above Anne is this batty singleton, April, who is everything Anne is terrified of becoming. And she recognizes that this is a kind of artificial fulcrum that she's set up for herself, and she's going to go one way or the other. But she's also starting to feel the clock tick. And I don't mean a biological clock. I mean a sense that children are nowhere on her horizon, but just a sense that she needs to start to make her own life.
Yeah.
And every day she's talking to 17-year-olds about what life they might like to make for themselves, but she's not listening to what it is she's saying.
And also volunteers Saturdays for public school kids.
Yes.
And she has a friend there, which is not really a friend, but she's an advisor.
Michelle,
at the school. And she said, "Have I got a terrific kid for you, Christina."
That's right. So Anne volunteers at an enormous public high school on Chicago's Northwest Side. And every Saturday, there's a volunteer program for students who aspire to something better for themselves. And there is a ringer. There is a Latina student called Christina who catches the eye of Michelle, the woman who runs the program. And they're trying to find a way to help Christina go to one of the top colleges in the country. This is really important. It's important in the book. It's important in the country. The problem for students like this, and this happens all the time, is not that they won't get in on their own merits. Of course they will, and colleges are desperate to find them. The problem is they come from communities with no experience at all of going away to a college on the East Coast. That's crazy talk to them. They may or may not be documented in their families. Even the thought of filling out a financial aid form is a threat to them. So Anne has to spring into action with Michelle to find a way to shepherd Christina through the application process, not because of her grades, but because of the background that she's trying to overcome.
Yeah. I mean, if you don't, it's like going to a foreign country.
That's right.
If you don't, and especially if you go to something like Turkey or Hungary, where the alphabet is not even
Cyrillic. It's all Cyrillic, exactly. And nobody that Christina knew in her family or her community had ever gone to a four-year college. Her mother was not at all interested in her daughter leaving for four years to go somewhere she would never see. And that's based very much in real life and on more than one student I knew.
Now, the author, Lacey Crawford, has done a very interesting relationship, because when Anne invites Christina to come meet Sadie and Sadie's parents, because maybe they will help with the finances for Duke, the housekeeper who adores Sadie and Sadie adores, suddenly opens up, this is Christina's aunt. Well, small world things do happen.
That's right. I think Sadie is a young woman who grows up with so much privilege and is always feeling guilty about her privilege. And then something happens that causes her to feel she's losing one thing truly precious to her. Her parents have never been around.
Yeah.
But Inez has been with her since day one. Yeah. And the fact that Inez is actually already family to this other young woman puts Sadie in a bit of a tough spot, because she's a good person and a good-hearted person, but she's angry and envious too.
Yeah, and she also has never really had a mother and father, except that they took her to always go to charity events or go to a country where she has to help.
The Miserable Children of the World Tour, yes.
Yeah.
So her parents work full-time and they were never there, but when they took time off, they took their children to volunteer in radically inappropriate places, like under conflict conditions in Sri Lanka, to show their children how lucky they have it.
Yeah.
And this is how Sadie has been taught about the world.
many people have had parents like that who took their kids to charity or orphanages to help out.
Right. Well, I think instilling a sense of community service and of social justice and obligation in one's children is one of the most important things a parent can do. Doing that with a sense of grandiosity or competitive volunteering,
yeah,
especially if you're considering what will Harvard think if she's been to Haiti, well, then you've perverted the whole thing. You've turned it on its head.
Which was the, suddenly I've done a blank on which parent was filling out her son's application.
So this is Hunter Pfaff's mom, Marianne Pfaff.
Yeah.
So students apply on the internet these days. There's an online forum called the Common Application, which almost all students will use. More than 500 of the school's top countries use it. And Hunter's mom is very frustrated that he's just a white boy from the suburbs and he's probably not going to get in where she wants him to. So just for kicks, she plays around to try to make him an ideal student. And she makes him a Muslim girl who has a part-time job working in a grocery store. And unfortunately, Hunter finds this. And this precipitates a bit of a conflict.
Yeah. And the father is really a difficult man.
He is a difficult man. He is unable to bear the thought that his son can't follow in his footsteps. Can't cut it. That's exactly right.
And Lacey.
You're not the first.
I know. What was behind the writing? The story.
Truthfully, I did this work for 15 years. I started when I was 22 years old, and I stopped in 2012. I had my first baby in the end of 2009, 2010. Just as I was finishing up working with students, we moved to San Francisco, and I had friends say, gosh, you're already too late to apply for preschools. You've got to get on the preschool list. And I thought, okay. So I called around, and I had some applications sent to me. And there were some essay questions on these preschool applications, you know, based on your child, why are we a good fit for you? And my son was 4 months old. I was writing these essays thinking, gosh, I'm the best person in the world to write these. And then I thought, oh my gosh, I've stepped through the looking glass. I know how this ends. I know how this ends. And what I realized for the first time is that I'd been doing this for 15 years with no skin in the game. I didn't have my own child.
Yeah.
Now I do. And every parent, I think, faces this trap. How hard will you push to help give your child a good start in the world? Mm-hmm. And when do you stand down? And you have to answer that every single day. I wrote the book to try to understand how that is at play in this one particular very difficult process.
Mm-hmm. How much rewriting did you do?
Constantly, all the time, the whole time.
Yeah. And did you have an agent at that time?
No. I finished the book, and then I sent it off to an agent who picked it up.
Uh-huh. Who was that?
Christina Clifford with Melanie Jackson's office.
Uh-huh. And she then took it around.
She asked for a few revisions, which I did, and then she sent it out, and within days, we had some offers on the table, and I got very lucky.
You're not lucky. It's really very well written, Lacey.
Thank you.
You know, I've sort of taken most of the book into my mind.
You have. I'm honored. Thank you.
You're very welcome. But it's there. I mean, it is readable,
and not
everything is this readable.
Thank you. I hoped so much to help people turn the pages, so thank you.
Yeah. What will they get from it?
Depends on who they are. What I hope to do is to offer parents a sense of perspective, a way to rise above this process, give us all a good laugh, and some solace about this. I mean, this is really ridiculous. What's happening to young people? But I also just wanted it to be a good read, a good story.
Well, I was very happy that at the end you have done an epilogue, so I know that where each of them finally got in.
Yes.
And what happened in their lives?
Yes. You get about the first 5 to 7 years after they start college.
Yeah, including Anne's.
Including Anne.
Going back to London.
That's right.
Did you ever live in London?
I did live in London. I lived in London for 5 years. I did not
really?
Do what Anne does, but I lived there.
Yeah,
yes.
What years?
I was there from 2002 to 2007.
Oh, so you were married at the time?
No, I left. I left to marry my New Yorker husband.
Ah.
That was my greatest sacrifice.
Yeah, what were you doing there?
I worked in nonprofit communications and management. I worked for the BBC, World Service Trust.
Uh-huh.
I did projects for the London School of Business, Oxford University, various other organizations.
Oh, you really had a wonderful experience.
I was very, very lucky.
Yeah.
And on the side, I was working with students at the American School in London.
Aha.
Mm-hmm. Students from all over the world.
Did that help them getting into colleges, the fact they had had a European experience?
Sure, and some of them were European, and that always helps, because if an administrator is trying to put together a class, they want a diversity of experience, absolutely. But it's every bit as competitive at the ASL as it is at Harvard Westlake or Marlborough or any of the schools we might have around us here.
Well, I don't know if you read the LA Times, but yesterday there was a long article on Harvard Westlake, where the kids are being over inundated with stress from, if you're going to be on the team, you've got to be the pitcher.
Right.
If you're in a class, you've got to be in the advanced placement.
Right. It's a kind of what I, in the book, talk a little bit about as a kind of Bobby Fischer syndrome. It seems that everyone is looking for a ghost genius, is looking for each student to be remarkable before he or she has even had a chance to figure out who he is.
Yeah. I'm going to ask you to just read a page from this book about colleges.
Okay. So this is Anne riffing on the stereotypes of many of the trophy schools in the country. Okay. Take Middlebury. One thought immediately of all the blonde kids with a green streak, the vegans, the skiers. Take the Ivies. The Euro kids wanted Brown. Jews, Yale or Penn. Wasps wanted Princeton. Cold athletes, Dartmouth. Hot athletes, Stanford. Cornell was big and seemed possible, but Ithaca was a high price to pay. Columbia for the city kids, and everyone wanted Harvard, if only to say they got in. Then the cult schools, Tufts, Georgetown, Duke, big states that shined like Ivies, UNC, UVA, Cal, the cluster of California schools, Claremont McKenna, Pomona, Scripps, USC for the screenwriters and baby producers, Reed for the ceramicists with sky-high SATs. In the Midwest, Chicago and Northwestern, polar opposites, both polar, and Oberlin and Kenyon, mild poets and musicians. Denison, rising fast, Wash U, sharp, but in St. Louis, the Boston cluster, BC, BU, Northeastern, Wheaton, Emerson, MIT, not so much. If you were the MIT type, you knew it, and you probably didn't care about other colleges, except for maybe Caltech, RPI, or Rice. Mid-Atlantic, Villanova, Wake Forest, Washington and Lee, and the middle D.C. schools, George Washington and American. Johns Hopkins for the pre-meds and writers who couldn't reach Yale. Davidson, which was not Dickinson, though both deserved discovery. Vanderbilt for the skinny girls with dreams of the South. Tri-State, NYU, if cash was no issue or you intended to train at Juilliard. The Hudson River Art and English School, Sarah Lawrence, Barnard, Bard, Vassar, Skidmore, B-plus Manhattanites, turfed upstate, Hamilton, Colgate, way upstate, St. Lawrence. The places where preppy kids went when they got turned down by their top choices, Trinity, Connecticut College, Richmond, Swanee. Big drinkers in mining country, Lehigh and Bucknell. The main schools, Bates, Bowdoin, Colby, said in one breath for Bostonian stars and lesser Groughtonians. Williams and Amherst, twinned, tiny, elite. Funky smart kids into free sex, Wesleyan. Funky brilliant kids terrified of sex, Swarthmore. Outliers, Emory, Rollins, Elon, Marlborough, Carleton, Puget Sound. Colorado College for mountains and a block schedule. St. Andrews, Edinburgh for those needing to get away. Rounding out the lights like stars scattered beyond the constellations, every state school other than the big three, though Anne was forever wishing she could make the parents understand what was on offer there.
You know, you could really do a rap song out of that.
Yeah.
Great.
Thank you.
Really great.
Thank you.
Lacey, a pleasure.
Thank you so much, Connie. My pleasure.
Well, all I can say is it's fun to read. I have a feeling you're going to be writing movies.
Oh,
film. Yes.
I don't know about that, but you're very, very kind to say that. Thank you.
And also, it could lend itself to television.
Well, you know, from your mouth to God's ears.
All right. Is somebody interested?
We've had some bites. We've had some bites.
Because you've got everything in it, you know, with the kids, with the people, and we won't say what happens New Year's Eve, because they're going to have to find out
for themselves.
But that happens too.
That's right.
And will you autograph my book, Lacey?
Oh, my goodness, with pleasure.
And
yes.
If you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. If you want to see some of the earlier shows, they have been donated to Claremont Graduate University Library, who have digitized over 2,000 shows. Or go to YouTube. We're almost up to 1 million, and you can see the shows from the last sort of three years. But support your local library. because really, didacts and people who are self-taught can go to a library and give themselves that education. And they will help you on the computer. They will recommend books that they think you might enjoy reading. And that's where the library comes in hand. And it is a fabulous place to spend time, especially today with all the new libraries. Wherever you are, libraries have been really brought up to modern speed, and they'll be glad to see you. So take a child with you, get them their library card. They never forget you. And if you don't have one yourself, get one. It's important to their sort of financing to have you get a library card. So with all of that and people who lecture and read at libraries, there's your answer. What did a library mean to you growing up?
Every Saturday morning is what it meant to me growing up.
Aha. Mother or daddy?
But they would drop me off. It was whoever I could get to take me in the car as soon as they would open.
And have you taken your son?
Of course, absolutely. Regularly. Yeah. I have two little boys. One of them is still a bit of a menace, but the other one, the older one, is there for story time.
Has his own library card?
He does.
And with that, every child who has their library card learns you take out a card, you take out a book, you return it on time and in the condition it was in when you took it out. So support the library, enjoy it, and we'll see you next time. Thank you.
Thank you, Connie.